You're listening to that blessed and highly flavored podcast. It's only because a nigga blessed.
Welcome back to Black Oak Couch Reviews. I'm your host, Christina. We are back for another episode of HBO's miniseries, The Outsider, episode 8, Foxhead. It premiered February 23rd of 2020, written by Richard Price, directed by J.D. Dillard. The ratings were down just a bit at 1.693. I gave this episode a 9.7 out of 10. Despite not a ton of shit transpiring, there was a lot of levity, humor, and fun, as well as horror in this one. I mean, I guess we did get some plot development, whereas the creature has now decided it's hungry, it needs another child. It is way more desperate and needing the proper sustenance to move on, and this whole investigation has thrown it off its game, and it leads to this very botched kidnapping, which is a huge stepping point in getting our antagonist, Ralph, on the page of, look, supernatural shit's going down and you need to get with it. So I kind of just broke things down by different people, not scene by scene. So I'm just going to go through my notes because I did watch this a few days ago. And yesterday I did a Westworld podcast and I completely, because I didn't write any notes, omitted a whole ass part of the episode. So I'm going to definitely rely on these. Jack, he calls in a distraction from his place where the cops are sitting on it. And once they leave, he grabs a shit ton of weapons. And his gun, after doubling back from where we left him on the ground in the forest, the last we saw. Plus, he has a police scanner in his truck. So he's able to identify that they are looking for his ass. He's a wanted man for firing on a civilian with intent to kill. Do not approach him. He is armed and dangerous. He comes across a fisherman who just was trying to live his best fisherman life and kills him. Then has to listen to the creature go to town on him. The noises, the sound effects that they do, if you have headphones in, very effective, the squelching. So Jack's barely contain nausea. He's just like, can you close your mouth? It was very comical for me. He is very remorseful, if not committed, because because he pulls over to the side of the road, and I'm guessing he somehow got in the backseat of the car, because you just see his hand, which was very effective, just come from the back seat, and you hear Claude's voice, but you know it's faux Claude, because it's Cuckoo, or damn, that whole time, you're never going to get me to say Cuckoo. Is that it? Cuckoo? But yeah, reaching for it, that was very well done, and he's like, pass it back. And I was like, oh, you're such a fucking douchebag, because he wants to gnaw on the pain of the family of losing that guy. He's insatiable in his desire for pain and death. And that's what makes the creature so just, that went the end, just so very scary, because he's going to eat. He needs to get to that food. He tells him that he's hungry. He's like, you just ate. Like, damn. It's like he's talking to his kid. Like, I just pulled over to McDonald's. I'm not stopping for another few exits. Cut to another hilarious scene in the caves where the monster is eating, but this was not enough for him. And he throws a human bone at Jack in dissatisfaction.
Man, you know what? I'm tired of you. I'm tired of this shit.
Here I'm talking, Claude's voice is also very weird. I need to eat. He needs himself a child, and everything, deer, whatever he comes across in the forest, humans, they're not what this creature wants. It wants a child. Next, the creature is, because I'm going to finish with the whole Jack storyline, the creature has the fox head mask on. I knew as soon as we saw the fox head in the first scene as they were passing this family that we had been following earlier in the episode or along. They're going to Cave-a-con. That's a thing, apparently, wherever this place is. And there's this very precocious kid. You really like him. He's talking about going through the sphincter and everyone's having a laugh at him because they have he has no idea what the sphincter is. And I thought he was really adorable. And the sister leaves to go talk to some boys. And you think that, you know, this kid, one, someone needs to have a talk with him about walking off with a stranger. Like, even if someone was like, you want to check out this cave, one, it's a grown ass person, and that's the first thing my daughter would be like mom. Second of all, I wouldn't have been too far away. Wouldn't have happened. This whole like 5 minutes, you may have gotten 30 seconds to convo before I would have been right over, like, why the fuck is you talking to a kid and you ain't got a kid? There's just something not right about that, period. You got a damn mask on too? Hell no. Just hell no. So he does buddy him up, get him talking. They start to walk off. Then he still has that predatory hand on his neck. That is not how you walk with your child. So I almost felt as if some other parents should have been paying attention at this fair, because that would have been setting off so many alarm bells if I saw another parent walking their kid by the back of their neck. I'm like, hold on, let me go check security real quick. I'm just gonna drop a line, even if I'm just being nosy, because that's not natural. That's not how I've ever seen, unless you buy, like, you about to get a whooping. But even then, your mask wouldn't be on. That's just no. Everything about that, like I said, had my sirens going off. And I get that they're supposed to be like an open fair thing, because I know there are places in the world where people are like, we don't lock our doors. I don't know that world. I've never lived in it. And I don't know a world in which kids are not within eyesight at all times. Sis does see the stranger with his hand on her kid brother and springs into action.
Not today, Satan. Not today.
Grandpa hears, and he ain't no small man. So a group of men tackle, or they surround him, and they're like, is that your kid? Because they're like, okay, we're going to be a civilian enough about it by not just knocking you the fuck out, because that would have been my first reaction. I'm like, I'm gonna punch you first, get this kid away, and we can ask questions later. But grandpa know damn well that ain't his kid and tackles him the fuck down. Faux Claude gets some pictures snapped at him, but he runs off all types of butthurt. Good luck finding where he is, because there's like 300 caves in this area. So great. Also, police now have evidence framing Claude for this attempted abduction. But turns out Holly's instincts were right, and Ralph exuded big dick energy when they showed up at the house, waving his badge around him and Yunis.
I got a Glock in my Rari.
Which leads us to our Team Kill Cuckoo Cuckoo tribe. We start the episode with them. Holly is with Andy by her side, getting her tea. He's already there to take care of her, telling everyone that the creature had to flee because of the investigation. So we need to keep putting pressure on it. That's the only way we're going to be able to stop it, because now it's made a mistake and it's rushing through its process, because it has no choice but to continue to feed and satiate itself. So the more pressure we put on it, the more it's going to fuck up. So her plan is today to go down to Claude's and basically be his alibi, an airtight one. So when the police show up, at least he has a credible person with him so that he doesn't end up like the other peeps, right? They got completely screwed over for the crime. So it's a really good idea, I thought. Yunis is there. He agrees. He says he will go. He's the first one to jump in there. Well, first Andy's like, well, I mean, if you're going to go do this cuckoo, if this cuckoo and this cocoa... He's so freaking stinky cute. But I was like, don't let anything happen to Andy. Please. Leave Andy alone. I am so invested in this love story. But he wants to go. And then that's when Yunis and lastly Ralph, who looks adorably uncomfortable in the corner. Everything about Ben Mendelsohn is doing it for me. Alex says,
fuck this shit, I'm out. Mm-mm. Fuck this shit, I'm out.
No thanks.
Don't mind me. I'ma just grab my stuff and leave. Excuse me, please. Fuck this shit, I'm out.
Nope.
Fuck this shit, I'm out.
All right then.
I don't know what the fuck just happened, but I don't really care.
That would have totally been me. Look, I support and defend your supernatural findings, but I ain't going to no fucking where next to El Nocuco. I am not sanctioned by the church. I am a civilian. I mean, I'm guessing maybe Alec is a little bit more than a civilian, but I know my black ass is, and I'm like, nah, that's good. I would be like how, what's her name? Shit, the one that got shot in the leg with the baby. She's like, I'm going to cyber crimes. I forgot to mention that last episode where she was like, yeah, I'm out. I don't want anything to fucking do with this. Whatever's going on with Jack, fuck it. I got a baby to think about and I'm not jumping on this case whatsoever. All I would have needed was one visit. I would have said, look, Holly, I love you. I will financially support your goals. But I'm not driving out there. Nah, I'm good. But, she does have her boys with her, and she has Andy's gonna ride with Yunis because Andy wants to ride with her first to have some boo up time. But she's like, I think I should ride with him. He's like, oh. But Yunis is like, we can exchange war stories. But they're also gonna have Claude detained. Now, there's a later scene in which Claude is detained, and I don't like how they handled that. I thought it was dumb. Yunis and Andy's car ride was hysterical, because Yunis is like, so you and Holly, you guys are like a thing? And he's like, what do you mean like a thing? He's like, you know what I mean. Y'all bumping and grinding. And he says, yeah, I really hope we're a thing. He really likes Holly. And he even came down here on this wild goose chase of a monster killing just because he's trying to get some more Munana. Okay? Can we not give this man all the love for saying the words Munana? I think that's still one of my favorite things about this whole entire season. He said, Eunice asked, do you believe in all this extraterrestrial supernatural stuff? And he's like, I don't know, but I believe in Holly. She says it's true. I'm willing to follow her to the end of the earth. One time she dropped it on this man, y'all. One time. Then Eunice says, well, has she ever told you about the time, or have you ever seen where she could spot when someone's gonna die? Like, has she been pulling away from you recently or doing this? I was laughing my ass off because, like, Andy was like, holy shit, is it? Eunice was like, oh my God, it's a joke. He was like, you got me for a second. He was like, that was more than a fucking second, more than a minute. I really like their conversation in the car because it's just boy talk, you know, crazy things going on, but I really like a girl. Holly and Ralph's car conversation is much more interesting and has a very funny joke at the end of it as well. He tells her about Jack, about how effective of a killer he is. This was a little tropish, but I guess a little of a backstory for Jack, that all he ever wanted to be was a sniper. So he joined the army. He excelled at that. Passed the next step in the sniper training. Then he had one last test, or he graduated top of his class too in both training classes. Then he gets to the last test, and Holly's like, oh, please don't tell me. And of course, he couldn't pass the psych test. So he's lethal, and he's also mentally unstable if pressured, under too much pressure, which is why she surmises that the creature chose him. And Ralph is kind of like, well, if this, you know, Kuko really exists, and she's like, if, motherfucker, we still here? But okay, continue your line of questioning. If he's real, what is his purpose? Why, what is he doing? Why would he do these things? And she's like, you know, she's taking the best guess case scenario. Like he's trying to survive just like everybody else. And she does say, despite everyone else, I like being around you the most because you ground her, because he grounds her. She needs someone questioning her more than believers, because it's easy to get very caught up in what you're doing so much that you could possibly be wrong, and you've led so many people down a path because no one is deciding to question whether you're right or not, whether it's coincidence or if it's something supernatural, because it leads credence to when it is supernatural. There always really should be a skeptic. And I'm not saying that Ralph shouldn't be skeptical. I'm saying Ralph has had a lot of evidence at this point in which he should start being less skeptical than he has been. But he's coming around. He didn't piss me off this episode. And I think by the end of it, he's definitely on board. He tells her a story about when his mom passed. There was a song that came on. I believe he said it was called Washington Square. Don't know what the song is, and that he hadn't heard it until he was thinking about his mom when his child was being born, or close to the time that his child was being born. And that song came on the radio, and he's like, what do you think about that? And she's like, it sounds like a coincidence to me. And he thought, you know, now that he's dipping his toe in the supernatural, that she's got like some everything would be a meaning to it. She's like, I don't fucking know. Like, I don't know. I don't have the answers to the universe just because I'm tackling something that's extra universal at this current moment. There is such a thing as coincidence. There is such a thing. We do that all the time, right? Where we're thinking about something and all of a sudden it comes on the radio and you're just like, did I do something to put that in motion? Does this have special meaning? No, it could just also be something that, you know, was coming down the pipeline in the universe and you just happened to feel it before it was going to happen. Or some feelings happen to be happening around the time that coincidentally this song came on that cascaded your mind back into some other feelings. There's actually more, one would say, scientific explanation for that. So I really like that. They share a very long laugh about it. They go to pick up Claude, who gets picked up by the police. He gets pulled over. He's went down to see his brother, whom I do not like whatsoever. What is his name? I can't even fully recall. But he's apparently a pot dealer. He works at a construction zone. I do like their chemistry as brothers, but the brother is just too much. He's eradicating anything I might like about Claude. Because Claude's like chill, and the brother's just like over the top, and I don't even understand why they're so cool. But they do at first have a very simple, easy camaraderie. It was into the latter scene that I was like, okay, now you're pissing me off. But every time they did converse,
you are now about to witness the strength of street knowledge.
I mean, they was talking about jail. They was talking about selling weed to the foreman. And he's like, let your foreman catch you. Hell, that is my foreman. And the benefits of anger management as they sitting on the porch, like, I might take a second class, you know, bro. Everything just about them is so, I grew up in the hood. But that other side of the hood that still thinks it's okay to talk back to police without fear of being shot in the face. Once the police do have him, I don't understand why they put him in a holding cell, because didn't Yunis say that? He says, I'm not going to have them do anything like put them in a cell. We're going to give them a night's accommodation. And yet that's exactly what they did. They handcuffed him. They didn't explain anything. Say, hey, there's some PD coming. They have to ask you some questions. That would have been the logical thing. So I honestly don't know why we went this route. Other than someone didn't explain to these officers exactly what they should have been doing. Though I did laugh hysterically again when the brother comes in, because he finally gets his phone call. He calls his brother and he comes in and he's like, why the fuck you got my brother? And he's like, you need to calm down. You can just see the black officer in the back with his taser. Like, okay, I'm gonna wait for you. And he's like, oh, you Forrest Gump looking motherfucker. He straight takes him down.
This nigga gonna run up on me like them old ass videos with Michael Jackson. He'll be grabbing his nuts and shit trying to swing a punch, nigga. Fuck out of here, nigga.
Nigga ain't gonna be doing no hee hee over here. Nigga will be like bow bow over here, nigga. The fuck out of here, bitch.
Then later on in the cell, he's still talking shit. And that's when Claude's like, man, you like it in here. But eventually, Yunis and Ralph get him out, plus the brother. They ask him how he's been feeling. He's like, it looks like it feels as if someone has been inside my head. He's trying to break in my house. That's why I moved from that area. It just feels like something bad's about to happen. And that's why I had to make some life changes. But I love the fact that he's so force sensitive to the fact like, nah, something up, man. Because he got that hood knowledge. Hood knowledge, you know. You don't ignore them feelings in your stomach, which is funny because we have another character talking about that as well. A different way of having intuition tell you something. The bro ain't feeling all these cops up in his house, though. He's like, what the fuck? Do you not realize, A, I'm a drug dealer. B, I'm smoking my weed on my couch in front of y'all mofos. And that's how it's going to be. But yeah, apparently they're like, we're gonna stay at your place. And I don't understand why the brother though was not fully comprehending what they were saying. We're here to alibi him because someone is trying to set him up, okay? I thought they were very explicit about that, especially Holly when she literally grabbed him by the arm. That's probably why he got beef with her. And she told him she better stop. She's like, we need to talk. I'm gonna tell you, we need to talk. I did love when Ralph was doing the stare down when he was talking to Jeannie on the phone, who almost hit somebody. Did she almost? That was just the next episode. I might have gotten him confused because I did watch them all back to back. But I know he was talking to Jeannie and then he started walking over to that car that parked like, is that a cop? Oh shit, that's a cop. Come on. Then we found out a little bit earlier that the brother liked to do puzzles, but he never looked at the picture at the box. And Holly looked at all of the pieces and said, ugh. And he's like, what, you hate puzzles? And she's like, no, I hate elephants. And that's what the puzzle was. So she was able to look at all the pieces and immediately know what that is, just a show of her intelligence. Andy and Holly, because none of them can get a hotel room because it's booked up for CavaCon. Nice way to weave that into the plot. So Andy elects to sleep on the couch on the porch because that's what you do when you live in the ghetto. You live in that type of neighborhood when you got a couch on the porch. And Holly's like, well, that's fine by me. I'm cozy out here with my man. Now, when Claude immediately was like, yeah, something's going on, Ralph goes and runs outside. So Holly has to jump in his ass once again.
Get together, Marcelo. Control.
I once again love that Ralph is not the quintessential archetype masculine guy. Like, you don't talk to me like that. He's just like, give me time, Jesus. And she's just like, do it faster. And he's just like smoking that cigarette still. Cause she told him straight up, go home. You a liability. just like his wife told him, Jeannie, earlier, like, you can't go to war with your eyes closed. You don't believe in this shit. So you need to step the fuck out of the way if you're not going to. You can't keep running out of the room in a huff because you can't believe shit in your pants that this is what's happening. Andy and Holly go shopping in town, and I'm thinking I'm going to get some Andy Holly moments, but no. She stops at the church, and she runs into Yunis there, and they're like, look, we're going to take what we can get, because we need some Holy Spirit up in here, because the rest of us still think this is a game. Ralph witnesses Claude's mental state in the middle of the night as he hears something in the house, and you see that Claude is kind of, he's fucked up in the head over this. He really thinks that someone is haunting him. Then there's a knock on the door. Someone's coming for you. It's the cops to say, we need to talk to Claude. Of course, the brother's there trying to be a dick about it, but then the real big dick energy, Ralph and Yunis, say, we'll handle this. You go on up in the house. So they talk in the backyard. They tell him exactly what just went down. And they even have video footage of Claude. And she looks right at Ralph. He's here. It's here.
Oh, shit. Oh, shit. Oh, shit.
Get ready for this.
Oh, shit. Oh,
that cop was looking between them like, excuse me, you want to explain that to me? Because I don't know what's going on. In other news, which was the other kind of comedy scene of the episode, Alec, who is with Howie, who's just, you know, going about the business, and Howie's like, so why didn't you go? He's like, oh, work. And Howie doesn't say anything. And he's like, okay, fine. I'm a bitch. I felt pennies in my mouth, which is something I haven't felt since I've been in the war. And that's why I was like, I ain't going. And then he just randomly pops up later. And he's like, okay, am I a bitch? Because I feel like I'm a bitch. And we left Holly all by herself. She's our guy. And we're not even there. Holly makes a good point. She's got like 60 years of police force experience surrounding her. But they're like, yeah, but come on. She's our person. And I did also laugh when Howie said, I missed another AA meeting.
Oh my God.
I'm like, you ain't right for that, Howie. You is not right for that. But that's how it is. Like, damn, we keep having these meetings all the time. Howie also did come to tell Ralph that Glory is suing everybody and they nuts off. I forgot there was a scene with Glory last episode. Where she said she was gonna sue, but not him. And Ralph is like, well, how do I get off so easy? And he says she believes you can, if anyone can prove Terry's innocence, him. Again, this is just a personal misstep for me, because I would have preferred that it was because he apologized and he's doing everything he can to atone. That makes the most, because it still goes back to my earlier complaint that it is a detective's job to follow the evidence. It's not a detective's job to prosecute. No one had prosecuted Terry. Yes, he was arrested publicly, and that may have incited public opinion. But let's be real, with the egregiousness nature of the crime, even Terry privately being arrested at home would have created the same amount of speculation. So I have a really hard time finding it, even within her going after the attorney general's office. And I know I had heard some background talk that Richard Price is someone who's very passionate about the justice system and people being put on death row or, you know, being accused of crimes when they're handled incorrectly and proven innocent. So I definitely feel the sincerity in that. However, with the case in which you're also presenting, you're saying that the police in one respect did nothing wrong because they had a overwhelming amount of evidence. And like I said many podcasts ago, if you found out that this you had statements, you had blood, you had DNA, you had pretty much other than a neon sign that said I did it on his back, and you let that person just walk freely among the community and that was released, or someone had an idea of that, that would have came to blow back in so many faces. And that's where I guess I feel the disparity in what the message is supposed to be within the context of what the actual crime was doesn't really fit. But in the essence of glory, ever since, I mean, all he did technically was be the guy that arrested him, but it's not, he didn't frame Terry for the crime. The person that is to blame is a creature in which Ralph is putting his life on the line and his career, and he's also doing it without not even being told to do it, right? So I would think that would account for more than, oh, I'm just letting you do it because you're the only person that can. Okay. And then we had the later scene of Allie coming back telling Howie we should go. And then all of a sudden they just show the fuck up. I was like, Howie too? I was like, oh, this is just more cannon fodder for people to be killed by this creature, because why the fuck is Howie here? But, yeah. That's pretty much all I have in my notes to cover this episode. So I will have episodes 9 and 10 out sometime this weekend. So look for those. If you want to send feedback before, you can send that to blackoncouch@gmail.com. My social medias will also be below. Remember to like, share, subscribe, and comment. You can find this podcast, Black Girl Couch Reviews, on Podbean, Stitcher, iTunes, Spotify, and wherever else good podcasts can be found. Until the next time, peace, hair grease, and Black Girl Magic.